was ice cold, placed in the tomb to save soul. This song for them hood girls, the whole world, straight masterpieces. Teaching about sin, forgiving the lost in the city. Got nailed on the cross of down, but now he's back and he's living. I got caught.
Here we go. Hey, welcome back to the channel. I'm your host, John Davis, and this is Theology Today 101. I do want to encourage you, if it's your first time joining with us, if you do like the channel, think about subscribing to us. Also, think about liking this video. And also, if you do subscribe, can you hit the bell notification? That way you can be notified when I post new videos. You see, I started off with that clip to kind of get us in the mood of what we're going to be talking about really quick about counterfeit worship. And, you know, when you see things like that in church, it's really not much to say about that. It's silliness. It's immature. It's turning church into children's church, you know, to come up with little skits and things of that nature that try to bring in the world into the church. And so that's exactly what you see in that clip. And I wanted to kind of show it to you, you know, because this is what's going on in the church. This is what is being characterized as worship. This is what's being characterized as honoring God. And when we see things like that, it's nothing wrong with, you know, being creative. It's nothing wrong with letting our creative juices flow. But guys, we want to make sure that we're not trying to bring in the culture of the world into the church. And we see that, especially in today's time, to be able to entertain people, to keep people wanting to come back. And those things can be very, very dangerous because we serve a holy God. I mean, think about it. Throughout the Bible, only God is called holy, holy, holy. Three times he's called holy, holy, holy. He's not called love, love, love. He's not called grace, 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 even though he is all of that. He is love. He is grace. He is merciful. He's all of that. But when the angels are around the throne, they're saying holy, holy, holy. And we see that in Isaiah 6. And sometimes as Christians, we tend to forget that we are serving a holy God. And we may have ideas that we want to do. We may have something, you know, like that little skit that you saw at the beginning that we may want to do. But we have to ask ourselves, is this honoring Christ? Is this honoring the Father of our Lord? Is this something that magnifies the Holy Spirit? Is this something that exemplifies what God would consider his worship? Because there are several scriptures in the Bible, especially in the Old Testament, where God warned Israel not to worship him as they would see those Canaanites worshiping their gods. In other words, God did not want you to incorporate what you saw the Canaanites doing. He didn't want Israel to do that. He didn't want that to be incorporated into how Israel was to worship him. And so even though we're under the New Testament, even though we're under a new covenant, that doesn't mean that God has changed. That doesn't mean that God is less holy. That doesn't mean that, you know, he's a sweep it under the rug God. Boys will be boys. Hey, let the good times flow. Bring it all in. You know, it's all for the good of the kingdom. No, that we can't have that attitude when we're approaching God, because when we do, that's when we get into silliness like what we saw at the beginning of that skit there. And so I wanted to kind of show that to you to kind of get you, you know, springboard us to what I want to talk about. But it can even get worse as we go along within Christendom on today. I mean, today it seems to be that most of the church is carried away into emotionalism, into feelings. You know, we're carried away into power signs and wanting to see some type of move of the Spirit. Guys, I'm telling you, man, that sets up the church very, very good for what's coming down the pipe when we go to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. And it talks about that the coming one who is the lawless one of Satan, he's coming by the activity of Satan, which is the Antichrist. He's going to be coming with all types of signs and wonders to deceive many. And so when we're caught up in all these different type of emotional styles of worship, To where it's not enough just to sit and hear the scriptures unveiled to you, to have the Bible just unpacked to you and be allow the Holy Spirit to illuminate those verses unto you and shine the light of Christ in your heart. That's not enough. That's not enough. I got to have feelings. I got to have more. And guys, it can get really, really dangerous. And so what I want to do is just show a couple of clips of what I'm talking about. Because when we're not careful, you know, besides the silliness, that's just silly what we saw at the beginning. But if we're not careful, it can get into more dangerous zones. So I want you to take a look at this clip of this church here. And this church is a church down in Florida. And I want you to get a flavor of what they call worship as we look at this clip. So look at it and then we'll come back and discuss it. Okay. You know, you don't even know where to begin when you see something like that. And if you guys may not know, that song is by a recording artist. Her name is Billie Eilish. That's who made the song. This, what we just saw, was actually done at a church down in Florida called Church of the Glades. And this is what they call worship. This is what they call entertaining. This is what they call the drama department of the church, to actually take a song by an artist named Billie Eilish, who has a lot of satanic overtones about her music, a lot of satanic overtones about things that she said. And they're going to take that song and perform it in church. Who are they entertaining? I mean, this is something that we would see at MTV. This is something that we would see at the VMAs. This is something you would see performed at the Grammys. But now it's being brought into the church. And when you see things like that, it has to break your heart. And it has to make us as Christians say, OK, what are we really doing here? Because we may look at that and say, well, no church is really doing that. Maybe that's just an anomaly church. No, there are several churches that are incorporating this style of entertainment, you know, in their worship services. And when we go down that route, guys, I'm telling you, man, we're entering into a counterfeit worship that is trying to bring what is really demonic, what is satanic. We're actually offering that to God as worship. Not only does the singing sound horrible, but look at the moves that the young lady was doing. Look at the dress that she has on. You know, she actually thinks that she's a secular artist. And she's, you know, this is what young person wouldn't want to come to a church like that and be able to sing all the secular songs and be told that you're worshiping God. Guys, that goes absolutely against anything the scripture says. And I'm going to show it to you later on, but I just want you to see it. Let's look at some more of this. So you're a tough guy, acting like a rough guy, just can't get enough guy, just a waste of puff guy. I'm the bad type, make your mama sad type, make you really mad type, stalk you like a fan type. I'm the bad guy. I had to pause it right quick. I mean, the Tower of Terror. I mean, what are we doing? The Tower of Terror, we got that actually on the pulpit. You know, they call it a pulpit for a reason. Either it'll pull you into the pit or it'll pull you out of the pit. When you see things like this going on in church, it is actually pulling you into the pit. Guys, no way in scripture, no way that God is being honored by having a Tower of Terror as you sang a Billie Eilish song talking about I'm a bad type. You know, it's ridiculous. Let's keep going.
You unlock this door with the key of imagination. Beyond it is another dimension. A dimension of sound. A dimension of mind. You're moving into a land of both shadow and substance, of things and ideas. You've just crossed over into the Twilight Zone.
Wow. So now we're crossing over into the Twilight Zone. We're bringing horror and calling it worship unto God. This is on a Sunday service, guys. I know when you're looking at this, you probably thought that you saw something on an MTV video award show. No, this is at church. This is what's going on. We're talking about welcome to the Twilight Zone, entering into another dimension. Guys, this is demonic. And here is the absolute horrifying part. It's demonic, and we're saying we're worshiping God while at the same time worshiping demons. When we have things like this going on at church, this is the worship of Satan. This is the worship of demons, but yet and still we're doing it in church as if we are worshiping God. Every true believer that's in that place should have ran out of that church. Every true Christian that sat there and saw this should have stood up and said, this is going too far. Again, there's nothing wrong with having drama or certain type of things that, you know, skits. I'm not trying to say that you have to be a real prude and square and, you know, we have to be like that. That's not what I'm saying. But when we're doing this, this is going too far, guys. And this is what church has become. And we're calling this worship. This is counterfeit worship. This isn't worshiping God, but it gets worse. I can't take any more of that. I mean, number one, you start off with the thriller laugh.
For no mere mortal can resist the evil of the thriller.
From the Michael Jackson album Thriller. And, you know, if you remember anything about that video, for, you know, those that, you know, maybe you grew up in the 80s like I did, you know, that video was a ghoulish video of Michael Jackson turning into some type of monster while he was on a date. And then all of a sudden the monsters and the graves pop open and all these dead corpses walk around doing all these different dances. Pretty much that's what you see going on here in this little rendition here of you have people dressed up like skeletons and ghouls and late, you know, the people in white dresses kind of walking around and dancing and doing this stuff all on the pulpit as parishioners are there to worship the Lord Jesus Christ. They're there to honor the Lord God Jesus Christ. But yet and still, when they open service, this is what you have to sit through. And guys, they sat there and they actually were entertained by that. That's foolishness, guys. And there's no way that we can say that God is honored like that. This is what we mean by counterfeit worship. And I'm making this video because I know we want to be creative. We want to think outside of the box, but thinking outside of the box does not mean to think in terms of hell. It doesn't mean that. It's nothing wrong with being creative. It's nothing wrong with letting the young people have ideas and bring those ideas into the church, as long as they line up with scripture, as long as it is honoring God. But guys, when we are bringing the world into the church, when we're bringing the Satan into the church to actually sit down and give us a show, when we now have the goats, you know, running the church, we have the inmates running the asylum, we have the demons actually being the deacons. Guys, when we're doing this and we're calling this praise and worship, we know that we are truly living in a great have fallen away from Orthodox biblical historical Christianity. Because, guys, none of this glorifies God. None of this does. And so what happens is when our worship is like this, and yeah, you can go across different churches, especially these seeker sensitive churches that want to make sure that they're able they want to craft the church to be geared towards sinners. You know, they want to make sure that sinners feel comfortable in church. They don't want to make sure Jesus feels comfortable. They don't want to make sure that the Holy Spirit is honored. They don't want to make sure that the Father is honored. They don't want to do anything like that. They want to make sure that the sinner feels comfortable. And to do that, now we got to bring in Billie Eilish. You know, what's next? We're going to sing Cardi B. You know, we're going to sing Megan Thee Stallion. I mean, this is what the door opens to. And we call this worship unto God. But guys, even when we look at things like that, and, you know, we could just call it as being silly, immature people, you know, ministers who shouldn't even be pastors. But guys, what happens when we're now just absolutely making merchandise and making fools out of people? And this is the pastor doing it. Or what we're going to see in this next clip, this is the pastor's wife doing this. When we see things like this, what do we say to that? It's one thing to see the praise and worship, you know, doing just ridiculous worldly things. That's wrong and that's dishonoring to God. But what happens when it's the one that we call the shepherd? It's his wife. They're leading the members into straight idolatry, straight a paganism. What happens when that begins to take place? Now, you know, we have reached 2 Timothy chapter 4. You know, we have now reached 2 Timothy chapter 3, where knowing that in the last days that the church is going to face perilous times. We know we're there now when we're saying things like this. I want you to see this clip here, and I'm going to talk a little bit about it.
It's 15 angels. To weaponize 15 people. Y'all crazy.
I had to stop it right quick. This is the pastor's wife, and she said there are 15 angels that's going to weaponize 15 people. Who are these angels? Number one, she's making this up. None of this is true. None of this is biblical. Angels don't come and weaponize people. The only angels that came down and did something with humanity to actually that went against something that's in scripture, that was the fallen angels that did it. When we read in Genesis chapter 6, are the fallen angels who come and posture themselves as being gods. And like Paul says, these people are worshiping demons, as it talked about in the biblical times. But she's saying there are 15 angels that she has control over that's going to weaponize 15 people. Guys, this is absolute paganism going on. But wait and see I want you to watch and see how the people respond.
Hold on. Jesus. God, can I ask for some more angels or something? Y'all some crazy folks.
She goes on to say, God, can I ask for some more angels or something? Can I ask for some more angels or something? Y'all some crazy folk. And to be honest with you, the way the people are acting, they are crazy. Because they don't realize that they're being led into paganism. They're being led into absolute stark raving paganism. Guys, none of this is Christianity. None of this. Listen, a scripture right quick. Colossians chapter 2, verse 18 and 19 says, let no one disqualify you insisting on asceticism and worship of angels. Do you know Paul was dealing with that way back in the church of Colossae? Colossians was written maybe around AD 60, AD 61. And Paul was dealing with this right then about let no one disqualify you, insisting on asceticism. That's the mortification of the body or the worship of angels, going on in detail about visions and puffed up without reason by his sensuous mind, not holding fast to the head from whom the whole body nourished and fit together through its joints and ligaments grows with a growth that is from God. In other words, you got these people that Paul is talking about that were coming to you because they were looking so holy because of the mortification of their body. You know, they were abusing their body, and they're telling you all these visions they have. The angels have spoken to them. They have warrior angels like this young lady here, and they're going to weaponize people. God, this is what Paul is saying. Let no one disqualify you with foolishness like this. All these people that are running down here, that are jumping up and down, acting like they're ready to receive a bouquet from a bride, you know, jumping up and down, ready to get the angels. Guys, all these people are being disqualified. Because guys, this is nothing but paganism. This is nothing but paganism. And when we see things like this, guys, we have to be able to speak out against it, because this is what's going on in the church today. It may not be going on to that degree, but guys, a lot of what we're saying is worshiping God is nothing but worshiping Satan in the name of God, because of a mass deception is going on with people that are want to feel something. They want to move. They want to feel some type of power. But like I always say, guys, there is another side in the spirit realm that has nothing to do with God, and that's the demonic side. That's the satanic side. And so, guys, when we see things like this, our heart has to break. But look, guys, it gets worse.
Now, oh God, are my guys ready? Oh Jesus. So I'ma let my angels do what they do. But it's 15 angels with prayer assignments. So let me move out the way before y'all knock me over. Somebody move this stuff out of the way.
15 angels with prayer assignments. And did you catch that? She said she called them her angels. Now, when we go to the scripture, we recognize that Jesus says, if my kingdom was of this world, I could call my angels. The scripture says in Matthew chapter 24 that Jesus is coming back with his angels. But I guess she got her own. She's running a gang of angels. I mean, she got an angel gang. There is someone else in the Bible who had a gang of angels that was not Christ, that was not the Father. And that was Satan. He led a third of the angels in rebellion against God. And so, guys, we can only assume that if she has these angels, that she has the authority to tell them that they have prayer assignments to give to people and they can weaponize 15 people. Then guys, maybe she's fallen sway to the fallen angel himself. Maybe she's one of these ministers dressed up as a minister of light who's really a servant of Satan, as it says over in 2 Corinthians chapter 11. Guys, we have to wonder about this. Not only do we have the problem of her being up there in the first place doing this, but look at the paganism of what she is introducing to the people of God. And guys, I say the people of God with quotation, you know, marks, because we really don't even know. We really honestly don't know when we see individual people who profess to love the Lord Jesus Christ and they're acting crazy because they're being deceived by a deceiver. Let's keep going.
Because in a second, 15 crazy people are about to run up here. Now. And I'm not going to touch you because, you know, I don't really do anything. But for these 15 people, God says the things that you are about to shift in this nation, let me move out of the way. You gonna keep me safe, right? Because they're gonna try to trample me.
These 15 people are about to they're about to be let loose on the nation. They're gonna change the nation. Guys, she's lying. She is literally making this up as she goes. And if you listen to the hint of comedy in her voice, she's making a fool out of these people. She knows that this is a farce. She knows that this is a ruse. She knows that she's just doing something to be entertaining, but yet and still the people out there are lapping this up in absolute sheer insanity. She's even calling them crazy because she knows that they're you saw the little text box that was on there. They're absolutely crazy to believe this. But yet and still, there are many people who are trapped in churches, are many people who go, and this is what they consider as worship. They're screaming, they're yelling, they have their hands up as if something is falling down from the sky and they're going to catch it. You know, they're shaking, they're thriving on the ground, they're wiggling, they're jiggling. They're doing all these things that we don't find anywhere in Scripture, and they're doing it saying that they are worshiping God. Man, we have to be careful. And guys, we got to pray for this young lady, man, that she repents and that she really, truly finds the Lord, because for what she is doing, she's going to answer for that. Oh, she's going to answer for this. But guys, I don't even know what to say about this next one. Let's keep watching.
All right, here we go. I didn't say go yet now. Yo, listen, some of y'all got 1 foot. Now, don't play with this. Because these are very special angels. So when I count to three, oh, let me move out of the way. I keep forgetting these folks crazy. Because these my warriors. When I count to three.
So guys, you have to see what's going to happen next. I mean, you can see she's preparing the people. She's getting them all riled up. And notice she got some protection up there, you know, because she's riling up the crowd. You know, she's saying that these are some special angels. Yeah, they're fallen angels. They're demons. They're very special. They're demonic. They're fallen angels. They have nothing to do with God. These are not angels that God has assigned in this church. This is just absolute paganism in this church. And so what we're going to see on how the people respond, it will absolutely break your heart.
One. Let me just look and see who's crazy. Woo! Yeah. I didn't say three. I'm just trying to see if y'all ready. Woo! Woo! Oh, these are big angels. Let me. 1, 2, 3. Come on.
You know what, guys? I hate to say it, but the fire of God is going to consume them. The fires of hell. Because, guys, what we just saw was absolutely, you don't even have words for it. It's horrifying. People are running up on the stage, men and women jumping on each other. You can only imagine what's going on in that pile. People are writhing. They're shaking. Guys, this is not of God. And no one with a straight face can say that this looks like anything that God would sanction. But guys, that's what's going on. And the sad part about it is, you know, a lot of people fall for this. No, they may not run and jump up on the stage like it's a fumble on the ground and you see the football players jumping up and down and going down on the ball. No, they may not do that in their church, but they have some absolute paganism going on. These people are under the sway of the enemy. And right now, guys, this young lady who's standing up there saying that she has the authority of these angels, she can do this. She is that Jezebel that Jesus talks about in Revelation chapter 3 in the church of Thyatira. I'm sorry, Revelation chapter 2 in the church of Thyatira. Because guys, none of this is biblical. But we do find a story in the Bible where we see this being done. And guess what, guys? It brought death and destruction on Israel when we see it done. Over in Exodus chapter 32, verses 1 through 6, it says, when the people saw that Moses delayed to come down from the mountain, the people gathered themselves together to Aaron and said to him, up, make us gods who shall go before us. As for this Moses, the man who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him. Now, remind you, Moses at that time was on top of the mountain, communicating with God, receiving the Torah, receiving the first five books of the Bible. He was receiving this information from God. And so what the people say, they come to Aaron and they like, look, man, we don't know what happened to this man. You know, we can't wait for God to reveal himself through the man whom God has called. No, we need you. We are going to you, Aaron, and you're going to make us a God that we are familiar with. And watch what happens in verse 2. So Aaron said to them, take off the rings of gold that are in your ears of your wives, your sons, and your daughters, and bring them to me. Notice, take off the gold and bring it to me. In other words, if you want to look at that today, bring me the money. Bring me the money and I'll make you a God that you like. You bring me the gold, I'll make you a God that you like. You bring me the earrings, I'll make you a God that you like. This is exactly what Aaron is kind of doing. And look at what he does here, verse 3. So all the people took off the rings of gold that were in their ears and brought them to Aaron. And he received the gold from their hand and fashioned it with a graven tool and made a golden calf. And they said, these are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt. Wow. Notice this. This is one thing when we read this story and we see the paganism, because notice, you know, Aaron takes the gold and he fashions it into this golden calf. But what amazes me is what they said, that these are the gods of Israel who brought you up out of the land of Egypt. Notice that to Israel, they were not thinking that they were worshiping another god. They just turned the God of Israel into a god that they could understand. And where did they get the concept of a golden calf from? Egypt. In other words, they turned God into something of the world. They turned God into something that they could understand because they've been in bondage in Egypt for over 400 years. So they understood how the Egyptians worshiped God. So what they did is they brought that type of worship into their worship of Yahweh. And they said, these be the gods that took us and brought us up out of Egypt. They turned God into something that they could understand. You got to recognize they didn't say, oh, we're abandoning Yahweh. We're abandoning the God that brought us out of Egypt. No, we're just going to worship him like what we're used to. We're going to bring what we're used to and we're going to worship Yahweh like that. That's exactly what they're doing. And notice this, it was done by the hand of a preacher, Aaron, who had no backbone to stand up to the people. And when Aaron saw this, look at what he did. He built an altar before it, and Aaron made a proclamation and said, tomorrow should be a feast to the Lord. See, they didn't think they were worshiping a different God. They're saying, we're making a feast unto the Lord. Now, mind you, God hadn't even given any feasts. There are no feasts given. God hasn't given any feast. We haven't got any feast yet. God hasn't given that laws, those things to Moses yet, and where Moses gives them to the people. No, this is something that Aaron is doing because they're turning God into something that they can understand. And guys, if we're not careful, we will worship God even under this grace, even on the salvation that we all share today. Guys, we will then end up worshiping God in a way that we can understand. And what's that? That's like the world. That we'll turn, we'll say, this is God. We'll sing a Billie Eilish song and say, this is God. We'll sing a Bruno Mars song and say, this is God. We'll say, hey, we got angels up here and say, this is the Lord. All because, guys, we don't want to be patient enough to let God reveal himself. And here's the best thing about the times that we live in. God has already revealed himself within the pages of Scripture. And all we have to do is look and see what Scripture says and make sure that we are aligning our worship unto God, just like what the Bible says. And look at what it says over in verse 7. And the Lord said to Moses, go down, For your people whom you brought up out of the land of Egypt have corrupted themselves. When you worship God in a way that he has not commanded, when you turn a worship into some worldly thing, some satanic thing, then guess what, guys? You have corrupted yourselves before God, and you don't want to worship God in a corrupt way. You don't want to offer God corrupted praise, corrupted songs, all because you're trying to bring the world in and you're trying to make God fit into this culture, make God be presentable to a culture that doesn't even want him in the first place. You see? And then in verse 8, it says, they have turned, God is still speaking to Moses, they have turned aside quickly out of the way that I have commanded them, and they have made for themselves a golden calf and have worshipped it and sacrificed to it and said, these are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt. Wow. God absolutely is upset about what is going on. Why? He's giving Moses the revelation of the law. So that he can now give it to the people. These people have turned him into a golden calf because they're familiar with that, rather than allowing Moses to bring the revelation down to them of who God is, and they worship God in that way. No, no, no. They're going to worship God in accordance to their feelings. That's why it says, and they offered burnt offerings and they rose up to play. Not only did they turn God into a golden calf, not only did they build an altar unto God and said, let's make a feast. They rose up to play, meaning that they absolutely worship God in some debauchery way, some debased way. Guys, is that no different than what we saw with Billie Eilish being performed as praise and worship in a church? People running up on stage to go and attack angels and fall at them and try to get at them. Bruno Mars and some ridiculous skit that we change the words. Guys, this is a fiasco. And guess what, guys? It's not going to go unpunished, because when we go read the rest of the story, we see how God responded to Israel at this time. But I want to show you something before I close. In Exodus 32, verse 21, because I want you to hear this, because Moses goes and speaks to Aaron and he says, what did this people do to you that you have brought such a great sin upon them? And Aaron said, let not the anger of my Lord burn hot. You know the people, that they are set on evil. For they said to me, make us gods who shall go before us. As for this Moses, the man who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what is to become of him. So I said to them, let any who have gold take it off. So they gave it to me and I threw it into the fire and out came this calf. What a bold-faced lie. Guys, typically pastors who allow their churches to go down that route, they're weak. They're afraid of the people because they know this is what the people want. The people want this. When you see these people running up on stage to act like this, she knows that this is what they want. And she's giving it to them. It's no different than a guy performing at a concert. He's giving the crowd what he wants. And sometimes you see praise and worship leaders do that. They're giving they see the crowd going crazy and they're giving the crowd what they want. And that's exactly what Aaron does. And guys, you can't say that you're a minister and you're giving the people what they want. No, you have to give the people what God has already given unto us, and that is contained only in the pages of Scripture. Guys, we don't want to be like the children of Israel. Listen to what Paul says in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 3 through 4. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate. That word accumulate means to bring to yourself in large numbers teachers to suit their own passions, and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. Guys, that's where we are right now. The larger churches that we have here are nothing but goat factories. We may as well turn church into MTV award show, VMAs, the Grammys, because guys, if this is what we're going to do, in order to entertain people, in order to say we're reaching sinners, Guys, I tell you, God is displeased and he's not honored when we see that. So guys, I'm telling you, if you are involved in anything like this, repent. God will forgive you. Thank God we're not living under an old covenant where these things brought death to those people in Exodus chapter 32, if you read the rest of the story. But thank God that God can give us forgiveness if we repent and we turn to him and then we seek his face to find out, God, what honors you? I promise you it won't be Billie Eilish. I promise you it won't be Bruno Mars. I promise you God is not honored when you're exalting his angels above him. But let's just be real. That wasn't his angels that she was doing. These were demons and fallen angels that she's doing because she's just making this up in her head. Guys, we don't want anything like that. We don't want to make worship up on the fly. We don't want to worship God like what we see in the world. We don't want to bring the world into the church and say, God, here's what we're offering up to you. We don't want to do that, guys. We want to make sure that we are honoring our Lord and Savior in a way that is pleasing unto him, God, that allows him to be the focus, that allows him to be esteemed, allows him to be glorified, allows him to be praised and exalted and magnified. That's how we want to honor the Lord Jesus Christ. And guys, we want to leave those skits. We want to leave all those things like that. We want to leave that to the world. We want to leave that to the world. So guys, if you like this video, hit the like button. And also, like I said before, think about subscribing to the channel. Until then, I'll see you on the next video. God bless.